Oh. Hey there, Ethan. Well, you know who it is. Anyway, first of all, please don't be intimidated by the ground rules thing. I have a tendency to ramble. Basically, it's respecting people and how they identify in a way that does not diminish your own identification. Evidence and disagreement. So that means no ad hominem arguments, no saying, oh, well, all these facts are just made up. If you have, you know, actual evidence that contradicts those facts, by all means, bring it up. And yeah, value disagreement. Just because someone disagrees with you doesn't mean they're disingenuous or evil. So, yeah, I could have made that video in 10 seconds, but because I'm really good at rambling shit, yeah, it goes nowhere. And you'll see in other discussions where if someone says something particularly busted and ad hominem and disrespectful, I say, well, would you like to back that up? And if they don't really have anything there, I say, well, then you're going to have to withdraw the comment or it's no more time to talk. But no, you're totally fine. And don't worry about not having gotten the video. YouTube took a week to let me know that this one was here. I just got the Gmail now. Let's see. What was the first thing I was going to mention? First of all, I think I'll talk about the original discussion, which was Nora Vincent's book. I think the interesting thing about Nora Vincent is what she describes in her book, she basically managed to give herself gender dysphoria because she forced herself to present as and be gendered as a man when she obviously wasn't particularly comfortable with the role. And that policing did get to her and did cause a stressful and dangerous condition in her. I mean, she did kind of live the trans experience, but like a lot of trans people didn't really take away the lessons from it. I mean, you see this among HBSers or people who universalize their experience. You know, Nora Vincent blamed her problem on the transition, which is true, but only because she transitioned to a gender that wasn't in alignment with her actual gender. Transitioned to a gender presentation that wasn't in line with her actual gender. So that was my problem there. Or not my problem, but that pretty much describes the thing with Nora Vincent, is she looked at the transition as causing stress, and it's true, but only because the transition was essentially arbitrarily deciding to assign her to an incongruent sex, which is what happens to us trans folk. Anyway, you were mentioning use of the word tranny. My rule of thumb with power words is, are they typically used to describe a group that you're a part of? Are they typically, or for that matter, have they been even somewhat infrequently used against you? Or is there a comedic or artistic context? I mean, I saw Patton Oswalt use the phrase tranny and use it properly. Because it wasn't, I mean, the joke wasn't even centering the trans person. It was talking about the hypocrisy of rural cultural conservatism. But anyway, that's beside the point. If I find the bit again, I don't know, maybe I'll link to it, but so let's see. Well, about your friend who is non-transitioning, or at least at this point is non-transitioning, it's sort of like the old joke, what's the difference between a transvestite and a trans woman? Well, about 5 years. That many people, myself included, Julia Serrano mentions this in Whipping Girl, move through genderqueer identities and modes of presentation before they get to something that's truly comfortable. And the more latitude with which someone has to move, I think, the easier that a transition gets. And that's not just for binary identified folk, but it's just like, well, try this, move on, try this, move on, try this, move on, you know, until finally someone finds something that's fairly congruent with their identity. I mean, yeah, I identified as the, quote-unquote male lesbian for a couple of years, and it wasn't working. And it wasn't something I used very often publicly. If you notice, especially on some very, very interesting transmisogynistic blogs, there's a lot of use of that identity to shame trans women and delegitimate trans women. And yeah, it's not so fun. But yeah, as to your non-transitioning lesbian friend who prefers male pronouns. Okay. I will say this. Nothing about transition, not hormones, not talking about it, not getting gendered properly, ever changed my gender. You know, I was female from birth. I was assigned male. You know, I was sold on the lie that I had to be a boy, because, well, hey, the doctor said I was. And, you know, I like girls, video games, and sports, so why not? And it takes a long time for people raised with that lie, I mean, varying amounts of time, you know, people transition at all ages, to kind of come to terms with the fact that that does not describe them. And then to begin to accept and understand that because of that identity, they can present in a way that is more congruent with that identity to them, you know. And if your friend, I mean, there are non-transitioning trans people. In fact, most trans people are non-transitioning. They just quietly, you know, find some little pocket of the internet or their own imagination to, you know, be gendered properly and treated properly, or just even swallow the secret. But I don't know. I'm always fascinated by people who consider themselves trans and then find they don't have an imperative need to transition. I have to admit it exists. I mean, just for the same reason that I understand that while not being operative, I understand that there are people who are operative and for whom it is a stressful condition, you know, analogous to me before HRT. That's all I have to say about that. There was one interesting thing you mentioned about beards being gendered. It's interesting how often we gender the presentation as opposed to the activity that leads to the presentation. I can tell you, actually, for a while during my transition, and I transitioned in boy mode, I mean, as this kind of shows, for a goodly part of it, especially when I was getting laser and my face was a bit raw, I would just take, you know, 2-3 days off from shaving, and I would have stubble. Which was incongruous, yes. But, again, it didn't degender. Like, I found, for example, I used to have fairly thick facial hair, which was not fun. Oh, that was not fun. But what was worse was the razor burn was not just unpleasant, but it was a triggering experience. It was like, here's this reminder that, you know, your very body is rebelling against the presentation you desperately, desperately want to have. And yeah, so for a while I just stopped shaving. And that didn't make me less of a woman. I find it interesting, the girls who say they'd want to have a beard for a while. I imagine it might be fun as a piece of performance. Every once in a while, incongruent presentation is fun. I enjoyed wearing a two-piece suit for a year, but in a nice place to visit, I wouldn't want to live there, as they say. And yeah, that's cool. Yeah, don't really worry about the rules. You're doing just fine. I'm just putting a whole bunch of pixels behind saying, you know, don't be dicks, or twats, or any other genitalia-based insult. There we are.